The Provost College of Medicine, Professor Folusha Oleshi, the Faculty of Environmental Sciences, Professor Timothy Luby, Deans of other faculties are present, members of Senate, ladies and gentlemen, gentlemen of the press. It is my pleasure to welcome you to the sixth inaugural lecture of the University of Lagos in the 2016-17 academic session. The lecture is titled Sustainable Architecture, A Return to Nature Through Biomimicry. Today's inaugural lecturer is Professor Michael Adeloye Adebamowo of the Department of Architecture in the Faculty of Environmental Sciences. Born on May 8, 1964, he attended Ansaruddin High School, Falulu, Lagos State, where he obtained his West African School Certificate in Grade 1 in 1980. He proceeded to Cedar Grammar School, Bariga, for his A level, and later gained admission to study architecture in 1981 at the University of Ife, Nabafumalo University, where he obtained his BSc and MSc degrees in 1986 and 1988, respectively, in architecture. In 1999, he became one of the pioneer students of the Master of Architecture program in the Department of Architecture, University of Lagos, and finished with distinction in 2003. He obtained his PhD in Geography and Planning, Urban and Building Climatology at Lagos State University in 2007. While at IFE, due to his academic performance in the first year, he obtained the National Merit Award of the Federal Government for students between 1982 and 1986 for his first degree. He also won the University of Undergraduate Scholarship and the OAU Postgraduate Fellowship Award in 1983 to 1986 and 1987 to 1988 respectively. Upon graduation, he worked as an architect with NMPC Mosimi for his AYC and with B-Works Consultants from 1980 to 1991. Professor Adebamowo started his lecturing career as a graduate assistant at the Western Law University in 1987, and later joined the service of the University of Lagos as an associate lecturer in the Department of Architecture in 1993, was promoted to lecturer 1 in 1995, senior lecturer in 2009, associate professor in 2011, and professor in April 2015. Professor Adebamowo has served the university and its faculty in various capacities. He was chairman of the Environmental Postgraduate Programs Committee in 2004-2007, as well as chairman of the Unilabit Environment Committee, and has been member of various committees, including University Teaching Facility Survey Committee, Unilag Photo Book Committee, Environmental and Preservation Committee, as well as Ceremonies Committee. Professor Adebamowo has also participated as the architect in many university projects, including the design and construction of Professor Adetokunbo Chufolo Memorial Park. He actually did the major design of that park. The Scholars Hostel, Zero Energy Green Demonstration Building at the Faculty of Science, renovation of Faculty of Arts Building, design of proposed SNEPCO Itinator Center, the Guinness Eye Center Extension in Daraba, proposed renovation and extension of Medical Center, Biological Gardens, Faculty of Law Building, and the proposed Faculty of Environmental Sciences Phase 3 Building. He was the acting head of the department between 2010 and 2013, and is currently the head Department of Architecture since 2015. Adebamowo supervised a group of students who won the first prize and second two category prizes of an international design competition organized by the African Union of Architects, and also led a team to Berlin, Germany, and won an award for a research workshop on lighting the global workplace sponsored by ADES Network Campus Berlin. After the university, he's an internal examiner to Ogbomolo University, Ife, University of Jos, Abaka Tafabalewa University, Covenant University, Bells University, and Caleb University. He's also the consulting architect, Children Learning Center for Internally Displaced People, IDPs, Maiduguri, Borno State. He's a member of Nigeria Institute of Architects, Architects Education Council of Nigeria, Association of Architectural Educators in Nigeria, Network for Comfort and Energy Use in Buildings, UK, and American Society for Heating, Refrigerating and Air Conditioning Engineers. He's a fellow of the Center of Environmental Technology and Pollution Mitigation, CEPCOM. Professor Ademawo has over 40 publications in national and international journals and revered conference proceedings with presentation in sustainable architecture, occupant comfort, and architectural science. He also attended over 100 local and international learning conferences. He is a reviewer and editorial member of some multiple journals and currently supervises 8 PhD candidates in architecture and successfully produced 4 PhD candidates. So that Ademawo is happily married and blessed with children. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my honor and privilege to invite Professor Michael Adeloye Ademawo to present his Nobel lecture.
Academics and Research, Deputy Vice Chancellor Management Services, Deputy Vice Chancellor Development Services, the Registrar, the Bursar, the Librarian, the Provost College of Medicine, other principal officers of the University, the Dean Faculty of Environmental Sciences, and other deans here present, members of Senate, directors, distinguished academic and administrative colleagues, Your Excellencies, Your Royal Majesties and Highnesses, Your Spiritual Lordships, all invited guests, dear students, gentlemen of the press, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. It is with a deep sense of humility and divine guidance that I present myself today, the 10th of May 2017, to deliver the 6th inaugural lecture in the 2016-2017 session of this great institution of learning, the University of Lagos, the University of First Choice, and Nation's Pride. This inaugural lecture is also the first in the Department of Architecture since its establishment in 1971-72 session. The fact that I happen to be the fourth professor to deliver an inaugural lecture in the department after 46 years of its establishment is significant. It shows how far the field of architecture within the academia has been subjected to a backstage, a less privileged position. This is a vital issue I hope to address in this lecture. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, after my training at IFE, I had a burning desire to take up active and private practice in architecture. With the grace of God and His guidance, I had the honor and privilege of designing a major church project, the CCC Ailala Parish, in 1986, and I participated in the tendering process along with my keyword friend, Gilema Fimidio here, and we supervised a first-class Italian construction company named Albion Construction. This experience launched me into full-time practice of architecture. My decision to join the Department of Architecture, University of Lagos, during the 1992-93 academic session was simply born out of my interest for academics. I therefore rejected all well-meaning attempts by architect O.S. Okedele then to make me a full-time lecturer. But in 1995, I finally gave in to his pressures and became a full-time lecturer. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, since 1995, I have tried to combine architectural practice with the responsibility of full-time lecturing. I also function as a minister in the church. These roles have been quite compelling, and I'm grateful to God for the limitless grace that He has given me to succeed. We are primarily trained to design, But the academia requires the development of the skills of research and scholarship. As such, the foundation of my research focus was laid in the Department of Architecture, University of Lagos, through the Master of Architecture program initiated by Professor Olumide Olusoya. I was exposed to research in architectural science, and my project in bioclimatic skyscraper and the Golden Park Estate were designed under the supervision of Professor John Godwin. I completed this program with a distinction, both in design and thesis. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, based on this background, I have done tremendous research and publications in the area of bioclimatic design, thermal comfort, energy use in buildings, and sustainable architecture. Through these, I became the only African in the scientific committee of the Network of Comfort and Energy Use in Buildings worldwide. This lecture is therefore intended to bring to public notice my research and practical experience in the area of sustainable architecture, and it is titled Sustainable Architecture, A Return to Nature Through Biomimicry. Introduction. The challenges in the Nigerian built environment are of different dimensions and complexities. The problems are both natural and man-made. These problems are also classified as social, economic, and environmental. Some of these problems, exacerbated by climate change and economic recession, include flooding, air pollution, urban sprawl, coastal erosion, and infrastructural collapse. In addition, the selfish lifestyle and thinking of Nigerians result into the following actions. With our bad roads and flooding, we result in the use of SUVs for the money bags. With lack of potable water, we result into sinking personal boreholes in our houses. With lack of regular supply of power, we result into use of generators, and we are almost becoming a generator republic, to the extent that the poor has what is called I pass my neighbor. With lack of security, we have high fenced walls, burglar-proof windows and doors, and God help you, that could become a trap in case of fire. Security gate houses all around. The cost of providing these gate houses, generator houses, which really are unnecessary in an ideal setting, is enough to build a simple bungalow. And these problems are shown in some of these figures. Flooding in poor homes, even the rich also cry, as you could see there. Flooding in Lekki, and high fence walls and the rest of that, and this guy carrying his generator, you know, jealously. But sustainable architecture is a key, as a key to responding to these challenges, especially in the light of reshaping our built environment by returning to nature through biomimicry, which is the focus of this lecture. The term sustainable architecture, Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, was first used at the World Conservation Strategy meeting in 1980, aimed to conserve, and later became popularized as an idea in our common future. It resulted in a communique, widely known as the Brundtland Report, which defines sustainable development as development that meets the needs of present generations without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their needs and aspirations. The primary goal of the designer, therefore, is to improve the long-term quality of human life and support the ecosystem. Future generations should be considered when decisions are being made, are being taken. In other words, be your brother's keepers. In honor, give preference to one another according to the Holy Scriptures. The term sustainable architecture, Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, many studies have used various terms interchangeably to describe environmentally responsive and energy efficient buildings. We have vernacular architecture, organic architecture of Frank Lloyd Wright, bioclimatic architecture of Victor Holliday, passive architecture, green architecture, ecological architecture of Ken Yang, low energy architecture, zero energy architecture, net energy architecture, and sustainable architecture. Sustainable architecture, therefore, is creating buildings that are environmentally responsive, energy efficient, socially inclusive, and economically affordable. In the figure just shown, the triple bottom line factors, when a building is environmentally responsive and is socially inclusive, but it is not economically viable, such a building is being referred to as being bearable. When a building is environmentally responsive and is economically affordable, but is not socially inclusive, it is referred to as being equitable. When a building is socially inclusive, economically affordable, but not environmentally responsive, is referred to as being viable. But when these three pillars of sustainability are in place, such a building or architecture is referred to as being sustainable. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir. Since the 1995 UNIRO World Summit, there have been concerted discussions about the fourth pillar of sustainable development. And three aspects were considered: culture, politics, religion. And out of these three, culture became the most predominant. But the adoption of the fourth pillar would not simplify the discussion of sustainability. However, the possible adoption of culture as a core for the three contemporary pillars will simply move the conceptualization towards an idea that depicts reality. Historical perspective of sustainable architecture. Buildings of these periods were climate conscious, and the style continued until the 20th century, as we could see in this picture and these other pictures during the colonial era of Lagos. At the turn of the 20th century, the building industry went through a revolution of its own. With industrial revolution came new materials and technology, which brought about bold architecture and innovations in construction, referred to as modern architecture. Buildings were no longer subject to the local climate. Also, architectural designs became international in scope, and we began to import or borrow ideas from other nations. Aided by information technology and global marketing, architectural designs have gone beyond locations, climate, and culture. Global economic recession and sustainable architecture. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, sustainability, when properly understood, will help to mitigate the effect of this current economic recession. There will be a long-term saving in construction cost. There will be better indoor thermal comfort and well-being. There will be improved flexibility and adaptability to meeting future needs. Thermal comfort studies and sustainable architecture. In one of my studies, I have been able to show that the majority of the people are living in a condition of thermal stress in Lagos metropolis, which has been associated with increase in cancer risk. Apart from the environmental challenges and selfish lifestyle, other reasons why people in Lagos metropolis may not live long and living in a condition of thermal stress are: one, haphazard planning layout, overcrowding, lack of open spaces, recreational spaces, because even original plots that have been designated in properly designed housing schemes will later be sold out to rich money bags, and poor sanitation and waste management, air pollution, poor drainage and environmental conditions, leading to increase in malaria cases. Therefore, we need sustainable architecture to the rescue. And in sustainable architecture, there are basically three principles: economy of resources, life cycle design, and humane design. And this figure I will quickly run through in showing us the principles, the strategies, and the methods of sustainable architecture. And I have been able to apply these principles and the strategies and methods in some of the designs that we have seen being displayed here. Number one, the first principle of sustainable architecture, Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, is referred to as economy of resources. And the first method here is that of energy efficiency. The energy consumption in Nigerian residential buildings has been very high due to increase in the nation's population and increase in non-climatic responsive buildings. Uncomfortable buildings drive the users towards high energy solutions, which result into the use of generators. Nowadays, as I've said, generators are no longer status symbol. In one of the designs in Golden Park Estate, which was a design I did for my MAC thesis, I will be able to apply this first principle of sustainable architecture in view of the energy efficiency of this area, in terms of the maximum utilization of the triangularly shaped land, appropriate landscaping, and with adequate open spaces and recreational areas, proper orientation of the buildings, deep overhangs in order to reduce solar radiation, and a design that is based around a courtyard system, as we can see in this serene layout of the estate. Apart from that, this principle of brick technology was also carried further in the zero energy demonstration building at the Faculty of Science, which provides its own energy needs from renewable sources, solar energy, wind energy, and biogas. This zero energy building is portable and relocatable because it is based on interlocking bricks without the use of any mortar joint. The same brick technology I carried further in the design of the proposed integrated learning center for the internally displaced people in Maiduguri, as we could see from these various pictures and simple schemes of illustration of sustainable architecture, and an architecture that is also appropriate for the tropical climate and using appropriate materials. The second method for this first principle of economy of resources is that of water efficiency. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, a building requires a large quantity of water for different purposes. A reduction in use also produces a reduction in waste. Recycling leads to efficiency, utilizing rainwater falling on building roofs, which used to be our old traditional practice, has been lost, and we need to regain that. Divorce rates, unfortunately, have been rising, and each time a family dissolves, this results usually in two households, resulting in duplication of facilities, either we like it or not. So what is sustainable architecture saying? Couples should stay together, return to God. God hates divorce. Return to nature. Stay together. Eat together and shower together, and there is water efficiency. The third method is that of material efficiency. Material efficiency demands the reduction methods in input and output of materials through adapting existing buildings to new uses, incorporating reclaimed or recycled materials, preserve and reuse materials, sizing buildings and systems properly. And I've been able to demonstrate it in some of my projects. In the proposed main library extension, even though it was an unsolicited design, but it still helps in the illustration of the point that I'm making concerning sustainable architecture. Well, I was able to do two options here. The first option is an option that is based on the contrast to the existing character of the main library, whereas the second option is complementary to the existing character. But both options essentially exhibit flexibility and adaptability with good view to the lagoon. And this is what we believe architecture should respond to. And it's shown in variously in all the floor plans as we have it shown. The same thing was applied in the design of the proposed Guinness Eye Center. For those of us who are familiar with Louvre, we'll be familiar with these long corridors leading to the world. And this design just tucked into the small available space over there and connecting in a seamless fashion into the existing building as we are. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, the second principle of sustainable architecture is referred to as life cycle design, which is a cradle to cradle approach rather than a cradle to grave. The methods here include adapting existing structure to new use and program, reusing building components and materials, recycled building components and materials, reusing land and existing infrastructures. And I've demonstrated this principle in the redesign of the renovation and extension of our medical center in Unilag. As we could see in the first picture, that was the building when it was in 1975 when it was constructed. It was quite an interesting architectural composition, appropriate appropriate for an institutional building and with emphasis on horizontality and good juxtaposition of materials in terms of the bricks and the stone being here. That is a beautiful design. But unfortunately, when they require a vertical extension, the addition that was added upon it gave a residential character and destroying the beautiful composition that we initially had. But we are returning this into its previous glory with the design that I have done now, as you can see, wrapping up that residential character and giving it the necessary institutional character. And not only that, the basic problems being faced by the medical center in terms of the breakdown of the plumbing services, we're also being able to resolve that by overhauling the entire plumbing services and at the same time concealing it in a beautiful manner that blends with the design of the new extension and being able to articulate the entire architectural composition, as we could see in this picture. The Faculty of Arts building is another illustration of this second method of sustainable architecture. With this intervention, this building arguably stands today as the best building on campus with this sustainable architectural features as illustrated. And I'm sure you will not have missed it on your way here. This is the building. In 1975, while it was completed, well designed as a sustainable architecture, but unfortunately over time, when the need for the use of air conditioners, the way and manner the air conditioners were located, actually destroyed the character of the building. As we can see in some of these pictures, any building that is designed and the mechanical systems are not properly integrated with the design, the users come in, put in AC anyhow, and at the end of the day, destroy the architecture. We have that happening at the Faculty of Arts then, but we thank God that with the renovation and remodeling of the Faculty of Arts that we've done, the AC grease vent, we're able to conceal all the outdoor units, enhancing the character of the building, contrasting colors, articulating the redeeming pattern of the floor. Classical example of sustainable architecture as we have it. Permit me at this juncture to congratulate the Vice Chancellor and thank him immensely for his support for the execution of this laudable transformation. I have no doubt in my mind that the Honours Committee does not need to look any further when it is time to name a building after the Vice Chancellor, Professor Rahman. The top principle of sustainable architecture is humane design. It has been the central focus of my research work that has brought me and the university to a global limelight. First, as a scientific member of the network of comfort and energy using buildings worldwide, and some of the conferences being attended in UK, in US, all over the world, in order to be able to, in speaking concerning sustainable architecture and the need to return to nature, are hereby being shown. But there are three strategies for humane design focused on enhancing the coexistence between buildings and their occupants. They are preservation of natural conditions, urban design, landscape design, and site planning, and design for human comfort. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, in the design of Professor Adetokun Osofolu Memorial Park and the Biological Garden, was able to illustrate this principle in the design. This is a design that consists of the focal point, which is the 7 feet statue, positioned to be experienced by everyone transiting through the park. The design concept was born out of the need to create a serene, sober, and reflection point to ruminate on the life and achievement of such a colossus and amiable late Vice Chancellor. And there is a solitary path which has a winding path to commemorate to the narrow path and ends in the memorial wall, as we see in that place, which forms the focus of the end of that memorial wall. And the vegetation is quite simple, quiet, and subdued, in line with the concept of serenity. The same thing is applicable in the design of the biological garden that is being proposed and we're still working on. Also apply this top principle, or better rather, in the Banana Island residential project In this project, as you can all see, and I know you can testify that it's beautiful, a sustainable residential development in Banana Island, which has an effective optimization of land, carefully delineating the public and private zones, and the orientation to maximize cross ventilation while reducing heat load through appropriate solar control with deep overhangs, with deep corridors and terraces and balconies, in cutting down solar radiation and with some vegetation to reduce also the temperature and creating the necessary ambience, as we could see in these various pictures. The same thing is applied in the design of the commercial high-rise office building for Credo Properties. And in this case, the sustainability aspect has to do with the introduction of the atrium in order to ventilate those public areas, having natural ventilation and natural lighting. And it's only the functional office spaces that have their indoor environment being mechanically cooled, as we see also in these various illustrations and the interior of some of these projects. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, sustainable architecture, nature, and biomimicry. Historically, architects have depended on nature for inspiration, for building forms and approaches to decoration. However, the lessons from nature, which informed many vernacular approaches to design, were later abandoned. Now, with the reality of climate change, there is a compelling need to return to nature. With the lessons from nature, we are able to go beyond mitigation and adaptation approaches to environmentally sustainable architecture. This approach is of mimicking nature and utilizing the principles and guiding natural forms and systems, Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, is what I have called architectural biomimicry. Nature works and contribute to environmental sustainability. Through these principles, nature runs on sunlight, nature uses only the energy it needs, nature feeds form into function, nature recycles everything, nature rewards cooperation, nature banks on diversity, nature demands local expertise, nature curbs excesses from within, nature taps the power of limits. Modern architects have used nature as a source of unconventional forms and symbolic association, as illustrated in two of these projects. The Beijing National Stadium is designed, as we can see, in the shape of a giant bird nest, the Beijing National Stadium. And this design is a striking and dynamic form. And we could all say that it's an iconic design, but it's based on the nature of a bird nest and the climatic condition of a bird nest for that matter. And also the East Gate Center in the shape of a termite mold. This is the building. The termite mold, as we could see, is on our left-hand side here. And the architect simply used the lesson from the termite mold in developing that design. And at the end of the day, that design uses 10% of energy needed by similar conventionally cooled building. It's in Harare, in Zimbabwe. Chimneys direct hot air out of the building, and roof vegetation reduces solar radiation. Termites were the primary source of inspiration in the design of this East Gate Center, which is ventilated and cooled naturally, even in that hot condition. And this simply is returning to nature, returning to God, returning to the word of the Lord, which says in Proverbs 6:6, go to the ant, consider our ways, and be wise. Ladies and gentlemen, there are many things we can learn from the nature. I've also applied this concept, or principle rather, in the design of the Center of Excellence for Unilab, to be sponsored by SNEPCO, in what you could see in this wavy sun. is a white waving sunshiny design, a symbolic expression of fiber in communication, because the building is an IT data center in communication. Applied architectural biomimicry in the form of exoskeleton with primary and secondary members. So these features are not just redundant structures, they are exoskeleton part of the main structure of the building, but giving this iconic form. That's the view from the engineering workshop and from the third mainland bridge. We have a view and a scenery like this. But unfortunately, because of cost, we have to cut this down to this simple structure. But this is still sustainable in the sense that, remember, sustainability has to be environmentally responsive, socially inclusive, and economically affordable. So we cut it down into this. And the plan still remains the same, meeting the functional needs of the client. Still talking about architectural biomimicry, in the design, the redesign of our extension for the proposed gate house, the existing gate house unit, quite simple, and it's an exotic design and a profound one for that matter. So all what we just need to do is to create a canopy over it, and this is done in this design that I've done in an architectural biomimicry way, representing yoke animal's intention and spanning and connected to an existing gatehouse with an environmentally resolving the confusion and the complexity around the gate through careful planning and reorganization with the use of also electronic advert and bollards in separating the kekemawas and creating a serene environment that is befitting for a University of Lagos, a University of Nations Pride, and a first-class university. And these are shown there. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, the teaching and practice of sustainable architecture, the integration of sustainability into architectural education is therefore both urgent from what we have seen so far and essential. However, schools of architecture are still naive about this concept, and most schools have not integrated this concept into their curricula. Peculiarity of architectural scholarship. Mr. Vice-Chancellor, sir, as an academic discipline, architecture is a multidimensional, multidisciplinary intellectual enterprise. To excel in architectural scholarship, it is important to be vast in almost all other fields of academics, in mathematics, in geography, in art, in science, in psychology, in philosophy, in sociology, in law, in medicine, in religion, in history. And this is aptly captured by Vitruvius when he wrote concerning the architect, and I quote, "Let him be educated, skillful with pencil, instructed in geometry, know much of history, have followed the philosophers with attention, understand music, have some knowledge of medicine, know the option of the jurist, and be acquainted with astronomy and the theory of the heavens." End of quote. Mr. Vice-Chancellor, sir, in architectural education, there is a persistent confusion as to where to place architecture, art, science, or humanities in the general broad classification of disciplines. In the university, where the program is run as a course, architecture has been variously placed in the Faculty of Engineering, Faculty of Technology, Faculty of Arts, Faculty of Environmental Studies, Faculty of Environmental Sciences, Faculty of Environmental Design and Management, and currently the Architects Registration Council of Nigeria, APON, is advocating for the Faculty of Architecture, classified under whatever broad category. Architecture is an academic discipline. As an academic discipline, is both science and art. The study of and the intellectual activity involving the science, which is the theory, and the art, which is the practice, in an academic setting, rightfully describes architecture as science and art. Mr. Vice-Chancellor, sir, architectural scholarship and promotion system. Architectural design should be understood as a problem-solving skill that is acquired by a process based on knowledge and insight entrenched in critical analysis and application of architectural precedent in solving problems of the built environment. the PhD program in architecture, Mr. Vincent Salazar, or any discipline for that matter, is good. And as it provides the necessary skill to engage in critical advanced research and scholarship. Indeed, PhD is a discipline that involves one's thinking faculty, and ordinarily should enhance the ability to solve complex problems in a scientific and organized manner. However, the PhD in architecture, as we have it in Nigerian universities today, does not translate to any advantage in the development of design skill in architecture. Mr. Vice-Chancellor, sir, therefore, there is a compelling need to critically review the PhD program in architecture. In view of this, the Department of Architecture, University of Lagos, has blazed a trail with the MA program at 900 level, which also leads to a PhD program upon completion. The central objective of the design-based MA architecture program is to develop a high-level manpower of leadership in architectural advanced design and research. There can be no good and innovative design without a well-established theory. There can be no good design, as we can see in this exhibition, without a well-established theory and research. And it is the MMAC program that empowers the architect with the ability to translate advanced research and scholarship into innovative architectural design solutions. It is expected, therefore, that after the MMAC degree, the holder of this degree examine an aspect of the research done at this level and take it further for a PhD. Thus, we are promoting MMAC PhD and not MPhil PhD for lecturers who are architects. Mr. Vice-Chancellor, sir, in the same vein, appointment and promotion system should be based on publications which must cover both portfolio, architectural design, creative work, and papers in journals. It is also suggested that an applicant be required to have a minimum of 20% of total publications in creative work and a maximum of 33%. This will ensure that every lecturer who takes a studio class is trained in advanced research and design, which empowers the lecturer in design studio to guide the creative process of the students with authority, as compared to the lecturer who is only a studio critique, however competent. Mr. Vice-Chancellor, sir, contributions to knowledge and practice. I've been able to develop a thermal comfort model for Lagos Metropolis, shown in this equation with a neutral temperature of 29 degrees Celsius. The neutral temperature is the temperature where most people vote neutral. Also, I've discovered that behavioral controls were governed by stochastic process rather than a precise relationship. In other words, there was no precise temperature at which occupants switched to the use of these building controls. Identification of thermal stress as a contributing factor to cancer risk in urban residential neighborhoods. Also, Mr. Vice-Chancellor, sir, I've contributed to the compilation of the ASHRAE Thermal Comfort Database 2 project, coordinated by the Center for Built Environment, University of California, Berkeley, which brought Nigeria to a limelight. And it is worthwhile. It is worthwhile to say this, that when the preliminary report for this research was distributed among contributors, we were shocked to find out that my contribution that came from Nigeria was credited to South Africa. And in our investigation, we were told that they thought anything good coming from Africa will come from South Africa. But we thank God that with this my humble contribution, now we know something good is coming from Nigeria. And Nigeria will surely fulfill our prophetic destiny. I've supervised and co-supervised 4 PhD staff candidates, and with currently another 4 at APC level. I've applied sustainable architecture principles in the design and implementation of our entrance caucus to the Department of Architecture, at which you have time to visit the place because it's now referred to as a tourist attraction, as you can see here. Very simple, but we're able to do this in such a way that the difference, the air temperature difference between this space and engineering car park where trees have been cut down, just about 50 meters away, is 6.5 degrees Celsius. The difference. This is huge. in the sense that even climate change, we are talking about 1.5 degrees centigrade difference in temperature, but this is 6.5 degrees. Thank you. Which the illustration, as we can see here, I've also supervised 3 MED students who won the first prize and 2 consolatory prizes in international design competition on sustainable housing organized by the African Union of Architects, and these are some of the works we have presented over there for this award, and Mr. Visi being presented with the award. And also led the team to Berlin, Germany, for a global lighting research workshop involving 5 universities from Australia, from South America, from Europe, from Asia, and Africa. And Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, University of Lagos represented Africa. We came with an innovation and we were voted runners up for our design presentation titled Strings of Light, an innovation and sustainable lighting scheme, as we could see in some of these pictures showing the design and the innovative way, and through that too, we're able to bring Nigeria to limelight. The same principle I applied in the design concept for the Faculty of Law building. The main design concept for the Faculty of Law building, as you can see, is pertaining to the functional plan of the Faculty of the Law building and applying the principles of architectural biomimicry with regards to the structure as an expression of equity, balance, firmness, thus underlining the importance of jurisdiction in the law profession. This is further expressed by the 5 frontal symbolic decorative columns, as you can see, representing integrity, power for the Faculty of the Law building, and defining the entrance approach to the proposed Faculty of Law building. Also, the Faculty of Environmental Sciences, our phase 3 building, I refer to it as building our future. And as we can see simply in this 3D, that's for our Faculty of Environmental Sciences. And this is an illustration of architectural biomimicry, a sustainable architecture connecting to the existing layout, and you can see the flow, that's the lift lobby, and moving on, yes, into the atrium, creating a good environment, and the atrium flowing into the professional offices at the last floor, and the green vegetation for the roofing, also part of the sustainability principles, and connecting to the existing building over there. And we could see the design of our property, which will remove completely whatever we could see there over the main entrance into the faculty building, and the old spaces were organized around this atrium. The exhibition spaces flowing from the studio, and we have this housing the Department of Architecture, Department of Quantity Surveying, and we also have all the professors of the faculty out there, the Dean's Office is also included here, and all the classroom seminar rooms and workshops and PhD seminar rooms. That is the future of Faculty of Environmental Sciences, that we begin to take our impact, and very soon we will be waiting for also for the completion of this building. Okay, thank you. We'll talk more about that. I also have for the Lagos Island Club high-rise parking, the same principle has been applied here. And lastly, the last project here is the Citadel, which is a redefinition of architectural, of church architecture, as we can find this. This is the Citadel building for the Lateran Assembly. And within this building, you see the illustration of sustainable architecture in the implementation of this building with 3 levels of basement parking. So we are solving problems. We are not creating nuisance on the road with parking. And you can find that all the parking needs being taken care. This is about sustainable architecture. And when we see the spacious entrance leading straight into the auditorium with the reception that is very warmly, And from here to the circulation space that will take you straight to the 5,000-seater capacity auditorium. Free with no columns, large expanse, and the worshippers have the direct view to the altar on Indus. And also within the altar area, we have the gallery, the choir are located in the gallery and balanced on the other side with the elders. And you could see the water fountain, all depicting in terms of the new definition for architecture for the church building. And if you talk all about the church auditorium, there are other spaces. We have the multi-purpose hall within the church auditorium. We have both the theater seating and also possibility of the banquet seating, taking about 1,000 in capacity. And within this, we also have the design that is within the office complex for the Lateran Assembly, that the office block of it connected into the main building. And even underneath the auditorium is where we have the fellowship. In terms of sustainability, no space should be wasted. Every space has been taken care of and properly utilized in this design. And this is underneath the auditorium that will come in that space. Wow, now we have the atrium. And around this atrium in the greenery for sustainable architecture, where we have the bookshop and the library, because this is a building that also attends to the totality of man, spirit, soul, and body, and your intellectual capacity in terms of development. And we have that in the demonstration for the bookshop, the library. We also have the classroom, is still going to go on. That's the classroom. We have 50 classrooms in all, taking care of the intellectual capacity. Of course, the restaurant, all still within the church complex and that church building. And you haven't seen anything yet. This baptismal pool also travels as a recreational pool. So it serves both baptism and for the spa, the salon. I'm sure some of you cannot wait for us to complete this project. Okay, Tapa and Dabato, over to you. We have the deal with God. So in terms of taking the totality, addressing the total needs of man, it's not a building according to Revelation 21:25. The house of God should not be shut. This is open 24/7, attending the totality of man. This is what sustainable architecture is all about. Environmentally responsive, socially inclusive, and economically affordable. Build environment professionals should accept responsibility as custodian of sustainable environment. The architect has a specific role because we have the breadth of vision and intellectual overview of a building project to effectively lead, which is why the loss of architectural environmental building control to project managers or service engineers for that matter has severe negative effect on the quality of our built environment. Urban infrastructure, there is a need for massive rehabilitation and expansion of urban infrastructure, plant trees and vegetation. There's a need to increase the level of green areas and open spaces in urban areas by encouraging the preservation of green areas and open spaces. At the same time, people should be encouraged to plant more trees and not cutting them down, as we experience in our sister faculty there. Architectural education. Architectural education should be programmed with this point of view so as to enable students gain awareness of the environment from the beginning to the of the beginning of their education. Not only that, Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, introduction of sustainability as a course in the curriculum of the educational system at all levels will most likely contribute to creating the desired environmental awareness, thus reducing bad environmental practices like burning of waste, indiscriminate dumping of refuse on the roads and drains, spitting of saliva from vehicle, urinating and defecating in the open fields, and etc. in the Nigerian built environment. Promotion of renewable and clean energy with more computerized high-tech will enhance digital power by aligning nature with biomimicry. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, we need to move beyond the current sustainability thinking of reducing impact and being less severe to a future restorative sustainability thinking of positive impact and doing more good. Thus, we'll be moving standards from zero energy zone to net positive zone. This restorative sustainability thinking is what we require to enable us progress into regenerative sustainability, where architectural design decisions are gleaned from nature through biomimicry. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, in conclusion, creating a sustainable built environment is not just done by integrating gadgets for that matter and placing it on the building. Architects need to have good understanding of nature. We need to look up to nature for inspiration. And this, I am saying, we will do through architectural biomimicry and not biomorphism. Acknowledgement. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, I am not only a recipient of God's grace, but indeed a product of grace. I am what I am today by His grace. Now unto Him, the invincible, the immortal, the only wise God, my Savior Jesus Christ, be all glory, majesty, dominion, power, both now and forevermore. Amen. Gabriel Adebayo Adebamo and Madam Rachel Folai Oshigo, both of blessed memory. Sweet mother, I cannot forget you. Your labor of love on us, particularly the fact that you instill in us the values of hard work, discipline and integrity. I thank God for my spiritual parents, here present and mentors, Apostle Bank and Sharon Akimola, all the way from the United States of America. Pastor and Pastor Tony Bakari, Prophet Ulu Osudi, to all my siblings who have contributed immensely to my academic achievement, especially Mrs. Shola Oshobo-Emekun with all the UK contingents. I'm grateful to all members of Shegun family of Ijebode, particularly at Edimola Shegun. When I gained admission in 1981 at Ife, he was practicing in Germany and he's still practicing in Germany as an architect. He came with loads of books and journals, even though I couldn't understand any word. But the pictures were very useful, and I say a big thank you to you. Thank you. God bless you. I wish to express my appreciation to the Adebamo royal family of Ondo Kingdom. I wish to especially thank you all, my wonderful in-laws, for the excellent relationship we enjoy. Thank you all. The journey to architecture was by divine guidance. I'm still coming. Just give me a minute. I'll get there. The journey to study architecture was by divine guidance, because when I was at crossroads as to what to study, God used this, my friend, during a prayer meeting at the Mercy Land at Ailara, to direct my path to architecture. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, I am eternally grateful to this, my childhood friend, who is here all the way from Maryland, United States of America, Bishop David Adedayo Adeoye, stand up for recognition. At Ansarudin High School, Kwalodo, unknown to me, the foundation of architecture was laid in technical drawing, which was taught by the then freshly minted, dedicated and inspiring Mrs. Omolara Tejosho, now Olori Omolara Tejosho. I don't know whether she's in attendance. All right. I must confess that in Ansarudin High School and CMS Grammar School, up school, I had great teachers and colleagues who lit in me the candle of knowledge and laid in me the foundations of scholastic curiosity and intellectual acuity. The foundation of my research in architecture was laid during the MArch program in the Department of Architecture, University of Lagos. I am grateful to Professor Olumide Olusoya and Professor John Godwin. Professor Olusoya, I'm sure, will be here. Also to my PhD supervisor at LASU, Professor Kaode Ojo, who promised to be here, but unfortunately and sadly died last month. May his soul rest in perfect peace. My inaugural lecture team, led by our own Obama, Dr. A.K. Adebayo, and all the members, I say a big thank you to you. I've been blessed to work with some wonderful students, Mr. Vice-Chancellor, sir. It was Professor Ogunye who personally told me during the last convocation exercise, while referring to your humble self and Dr. Ogunaya Ono, that some of our students are really more brilliant than lecturers, and that lecturers are only privileged to be their teachers by virtue of being older. I didn't say it, Professor Ogunye said it. I cannot agree more with Professor Ogunye. Indeed, our students have fulfilled the scripture in Psalm 119:99, verse 39, by knowing better than their teachers. All my 3D presentations, 3D models, animation was presented in this lecture were done either by my current students or former students. Our students are simply fantastic. They are phenomenal. I wish to express my profound gratitude and sense of appreciation to the university management under the able leadership of the Vice-Chancellor, Professor Rahman Bello, for the opportunity given me to present this inaugural lecture today and for the support and cooperation received as HOD Architecture. Never to forget our amiable Vice-Chancellor, Professor Adetokunbo Babatunde Sefoluwe, an old grammarian of school, who appointed me as acting HOD in 2010. Giving me an opportunity to cut my teeth on university administrative matters. It was therefore a great honor for me to be called to design and construct the Professor Sefoluwe Park. Massive thanks to Mr. Vice-Chancellor. Mr. Vice-Chancellor, sir. I wish to express my deep appreciation to some great Nigerians with whom I've had close working relationship and acquired tremendous leadership experience. They are the former Minister of Education, Ambassador Professor Tunde Adeniran, here present. The former Chief of Defense Staff, Air Chief Marshal Paul Dike, then Air Vice Marshal and Irulu Oji Martins, Air Vice Marshal Dolawo Adekunle, we have Chief Jola Pamo, and all these eminent personalities who had come from far and near to be here today. I cannot mention you all. I just want to say a big thank you to every one of you. To my spiritual family, Grace and Glory Chapel, Shiloh Team International Fellowship, and World Outreach Missions Apostolic Network, Capro, NEMA, and the Father, Royal Fathers, that we propagate the gospel together. The Allied Badu of Aribadu of Badileke Alade Babajide, the Ulu of Uwode, His Royal Majesty of Reverend F.S. Akin Dele, I want to say a big thank you to every one of you. Finally, Mr. Vice-Chancellor, sir, I have been blessed with a good loving wife and a three wonderful children. Deborah Olufumilayo is studying medicine in St. George's University after a pre-degree in Salisbury University. Michael Ayomipo, they are both not here, is a 300 level architecture student at the University of Maryland College Park. And David, King David is here, is basic 7 ISL Unilad. Stand up for recognition. To my own apostolic brother, the commander-in-chief, and all in all, not only in home affairs, but in ministry, construction site, practice, just name it. I'm able to succeed as a teacher, pastor, and architect because of this rare gift, who stands always like a rock of Gibraltar. Pastor Oyeyemi Adibaba, will you stand up for recognition? This is the secret of my success. She turns 50 in the next few months. Check her out, still looking 21. I'm eternally grateful for your love, kindness, unflinching support, and forthrightness. For all my family members, friends, associates, too numerous to mention your names, please pardon me. From Europe and America, I feel greatly honored that you are all here. I thank you all for your attention. Mr. Vice-Chancellor, I am done.
Environment Services, Professor Ben Ogujafo, the Registrar, Dr. Taiwo Ifeanyi, the University Porter, Dr. Latif Odekunle, the University Librarian, Dr. Olukemi Fadeyan, Professor of Medicine, Professor Leshi, Dean, Faculty of Medical Sciences, Professor Timothy Nubi, other deans here present, former bachelors of universities here present, members of Senate of the University of Lagos, invited academics from all over the country and beyond. Let me also try to recognize a few people that I can pick. If I don't mention you, please don't worry. The Nobel lecturer has actually done that big job. But I made understand that His Excellency Dr. Polakpo Onishola, Deputy Governor of the State, is here. For the second. I also learned that our own great alumnus, Pastor Tunde Bakare and Mr. Bakare, are here. I'd like to also mention Air Marshal Paul Dike, former Chief of Air Staff of Federal Force of Nigeria. And Professor Tunde Adeniran, the former Honorable Minister of Education. I'm also informed that we have Mrs. Cecilia Omulara Fashola here, the mother of the Honorable Minister of Power. Ambassador Doe and Mrs. Remy Esson, we also recognize you. I particularly recognize all the MDs of the major construction companies that are here. Kappa and Abato, Epo, and all the others that are involved. The Royal Majesties of MS Akindele Oluwabowode Yewa, as well as Ali Bajo. Bishop David Adeloye. Mr. Adeloye, welcome you. Of course, I can't forget Professor Ayobuye that has been mentioned and we've had to. Well, let me also generally recognize Mrs. Olushola Osho Bemeku. And other members of the Adebamo family that are here. Thank you. The Celestial Church of Christ, Lagos Central Province, K, you are all recognized. And finally, the Apostolic Mother of the Lecturer and the Commander-in-Chief of his house. And David Adebamowo as well. We look forward to the day you also began your national show in day four. Of course, I must not forget the supporters of lecturer from Rachexo, the great Akokai. Great Akokai! We have had Professor Michael Adeloye return to nature through biomimicry. For First of all, I want to attest to the contributions of Professor Adebamowo in all the projects that he mentioned relating to the University of Lagos. This one also attests to the fact that at the University of Lagos, we encourage our professionals to put their profession into practice through our projects on campus. I believe this has also helped them to also grow in putting all their theories and findings in some of their projects. Congratulations, Professor Adebamowo. The lecturer, when investigating the thermal characteristics of the outdoor and indoor conditions of naturally ventilated residential buildings in Lagos metropolis, found out that the outdoor temperature is not that significantly different from the indoor temperature. The outdoor air velocity is similarly different from the indoor air velocity, implying that the designs of residential buildings in Lagos metropolis are poor with respect to thermal comfort. I think this is what is stressed in most of the designs that is doing currently now. It also made us understand that 30% of energy consumed in Lagos residential buildings is used for lighting and ventilation, and use of generators is no longer a status symbol but a necessity. Another study carried out examined an aspect of environmental stress on important contributing factors to cancer risk. It didn't emphasize that. In an urban residential neighborhood, and found that people are living in a condition of thermal stress, and this may also be associated to increased cancer risk. The professor applied the three principles of sustainable architecture, that is, economy of resources, life cycle design, and humane design, in the conceptualization and design of an international award-winning sustainable housing project at Makoko, and virtually in all the designs that have been involved with lately. With this lecture, Professor Adebamowo has been able to show that creating a sustainable built environment is not just by integrating gadgets on buildings, but by exploring the unity between architecture and nature through biomimicry and not biomorphism. Professor Michael Adeloye Adebamowo, now that you have suddenly paid your academic debt to the University of Lagos, with today's very excellent longer lecture, well described and well illustrated and presented, and which has immense contribution to improve our world, on behalf of the Senate of the University of Lagos, you are hereby discharged and acquitted. I would therefore like to welcome you to the committee of professors that have paid their dues. Congratulations. I'd like to enjoin you to please carry on mentoring others coming behind so that you can impart all your findings on those that are coming behind you. I want to thank you all for coming. I wish you safe return to your great destination. Amen. I declare this assembly closed. Thank you.